as many of you know, the church here has been really used of the Lord to really begin to work with some people in Washington, D.C., people who are of influence, people who are lobbyists, people who are chief of staffs and things like that. So Todd and I and Mike and Penny Norman were out there at the British Petroleum Executive Room this last Thursday evening, and it has grown. It started with four. They had about 25, 26 there. Matter of fact, the executive boardroom's packed out. So now, as a matter of fact, while we were meeting there, the CEO of British Petroleum was meeting in the boardroom across the way and other people. And Sally, who works for BP, was released to be able to be in the meeting with us. But they have to move into a larger room now. So it's growing, and God is doing powerful things. What we don't see, I say it over and over again, God is doing more behind our back than in front of our face. And this is an apolitical meeting because, matter of fact, one of the new gals there, a Latino gal, she heads up the Latino coalition and is very tied into the Democratic Party. She came into this and she said her first time there, she was kind of taken back because she knows that most of the people there are Trump supporters or whatever, but she felt the presence of God there so strong she had to keep coming. The testimonies we listen to of the changed, transformed lives that are there. I mean, Todd, Mike, and Penny can tell you just how powerful the message and the gospel of the kingdom of God going forth in their life. So they see something. There's something above their politics. There's something above their life, and that is the kingdom of God rises above all of it. Amen. So we could share so much on that, but just neat testimony. So, amen. We're looking forward to all that God is doing there. Matter of fact, while we were there, I think this is probably the first time we ever sat in a ministry, a fivefold pastor. It's probably the first time ever that British Petroleum in their boardroom has had somebody ordained as a pastor in their boardroom. I like first. I like always being out on the cutting edge of what God is doing. So exciting. Peter Norman, their son, he's a lobbyist, the chief lobbyist, and for Alchemy's pharmaceutical company, but he's also a pastor, and it's amazing how he cares for all these different people in D.C. As a matter of fact, Matthew Micah, when he was shot, remember the shootings that took place, and the bullet came out through his chest the size of a baseball. He was up in the hospital room. Nobody could get in there. Nobody. They had Secret Service there, FBI, everything else. The Secret Service got Peter up in there to pray for Matt Micah. Matt Micah is not a believer, but now he's asking questions about the Lord. So this is exciting stuff. Let's give the Lord a hand, man. That's what it's about. None of us. It's all Him. You see? But we have to be willing to step out in faith. So we're going to go back in here. I don't think I'll get through it today as well. We've been going through Nehemiah some. And as we've been looking at Nehemiah, I'm not going to go through past teachings and that. You'll just have to go to our podcast and listen to those as myself and Ellie of others have shared out of Nehemiah there. But I'm focusing in on a very particular scripture about them building their wall. And the lessons we can learn from Nehemiah. Because when we talk about Nehemiah had this burden when he heard what was going on back in Jerusalem. He was under, you know, captivity, if you will, but had favor with King Cyrus, and he was released with people and the protection of the king to go back to Jerusalem and build the wall. What does that speak to you and I? When we look at something in the Old Testament or a portion of Scripture, how do we apply that to our lives? Well, that wall they were building was an assignment from God Himself. And every one of us here have an assignment. We have a job to do. And when we stand before the Lord, we will give an account for what we did with that. This isn't for our salvation as to whether we can enter because the blood of Jesus covers that. But it is for reward and to hear those beautiful words, what's catch that? Amen. How many want to hear those words? When you stand before the Lord. Now, let me just make a disclaimer here when I use my graphic up here. This is not a promotion or advertisement for bald people. I don't want anybody to feel bad or feel extra good. It's just graphics I could find, all right? So as we look at this, I want you to go with me to Nehemiah chapter 4. Nehemiah chapter 4. And we're going to be looking at several scriptures as we go through these series. And I want to say it talks about, in the end times, a famine for the Word of God. And that famine exists in His church. And let me say to those of us who are used to sound bites and getting more used to sound bites and snippets of information, and even to our younger generations who live off of just snippets of information off the social networks, etc., we need to be well acquainted with this word. It's an issue of life and death. We cannot make excuses for our ignorance, lack of understanding of the Word of God. And we will always carry forth the Word. So I want to focus, because we've looked at many scriptures here, but I want to focus specifically on a couple verses. I want you to go with me to chapter 4, verse 16 and 17 of Nehemiah. And it happened when our enemies heard, 16. So it was from that time on that half of my servants worked at construction, while the other half held spears, the shields, the bows, they wore, and wore armor. And the leaders were behind all the house of Judah. Verse 17. Those who built on the wall and those who carried burdens loaded themselves so that with one hand they worked at the construction and the other hand they held a weapon. Let me give another translation of verse 17. The builders and their helpers had their tools in one hand and their weapons in another hand. How do we apply that to you and I? This illustration. Building the wall, fulfilling our assignment, doing what God has asked us to do, will be both work and warfare. And we must master both. The enemy is not going to let you go. A matter of fact, it says in the Scripture, 2 Timothy 3:12, that all who wish to live godly in Christ Jesus, I'll stop right there and ask, how many who wish to live godly in Christ Jesus? Raise your hand if you wish to live godly in Christ Jesus. He says, therefore, all those who wish to live godly in Christ Jesus, not maybe, might be, could be, would be, but shall suffer persecution. And if you're not mentally prepared for that, and not only mentally prepared, if you do not have the skill set coming out of the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, you're going to get beat up more than you ought to be. Now, I'm not going to lay a lot on work, but what we define our work, as a matter of fact, many people think work is a bad word. But we see that in Genesis chapter 2, when God created Adam and took Eve out of Adam, and they're in the garden. Before the fall, God created Adam and He told him to work the garden. Work is a blessing. And if you've ever been out of it for a long period of time, how many of you know you say it's a blessing? Am I right? And that Hebrew word, the root of abad, the Hebrew word for work there, is translated elsewhere in the Old Testament as worship. So what we need to see is work is worship. Say that with me. Work is worship. So on Monday morning, tomorrow morning, you're not going to work, you're going to worship. Even if you're working a mundane job, pulling that lever on a machine time after time, you are worshiping God if you're doing it unto the Lord. And if you're alert and watching, what's going on around you. You can be praying under your breath. You can be praying in the spirit and understanding. You can be lifting people up. And when you hear somebody that's hurting and down, you could be their answer, carrying the Lord Jesus Christ to them. And what we're going to be looking at as we continue forward here, we keep doing it somewhat, we're going to be looking at how God has wired us, because we understand what our job and assignment is by the tools He gives us. A construction worker has different tools than a brain surgeon. Aren't you glad? And how many of you know, you don't want the best construction worker to do your brain surgery? Any more than you want that brain surgeon to put that addition on your house. All are needed. All have skills. But the problem in the body of Christ, most of us have never learned our spiritual DNA. It's like we say, when I got born again, born from above, born from the beginning, as the Aramaic says, when I was born again, my DNA changed addresses. It is now in the kingdom of God. And every one of us need to embrace that understanding. So, learning what spiritual gifts and tools that God's given you, and we'll keep developing those things, will help you understand what your assignment is. Guess what somebody who has gifts, plural, of healings, plural, what their assignment is? Was that card? Healing. And we could go on, but last week I shared with you a lot of the things as far as our work is given to us at birth. Yeah. Are you born a male or female? Gender affects our assignment. Because a godly man needs to live as a godly man and show what manhood is all about. A godly woman needs to live as a godly woman and show what womanhood is all about. According to the scriptures, not according to the warfare and all the bombardment of everything we get from our society, everything else. So, if you're born a male, good chance you're going to be a what male? Yes, that's good. That's good. No confusion in the house here. But as you grow up, you're going to be a husband, right? And you're going to be a father. Now, fathers, you've got to work as a father, and you've got to go to war as a father. I want to tell you something. In our educational institutions, they are teaching things that are absolutely ungodly, devilish, and of the wisdom that is of this earth. So what is he going to do? What are you going to do as a father and a mother? You've got to fight. You've got to go to war. I saw in the UK they want to get rid of all sports where there's competition because they don't want anybody to feel bad. Dad and mom, you better teach your children what it's like to fall and get back up and keep going forward. You better teach them what it's like to fight in this world, because they will never be successful if you don't teach them how to fail forward. Building the wall in their lives is so important. The things they tell us today, and matter of fact, even try to arrest us or do things if we live by the scriptures. Look, it is warfare. It is warfare. And so we have to recognize that every role that we have, going to work, people are in workplaces where it's the pressure is put upon them to do something that is not right, not with integrity. And to be able to stand up and say, I cannot do that. Because the job all of us have, based on not our natural birth, but our spiritual birth, because you've been born again. And so the job we were given when we were born again, when we were recreated, is as an ambassador of the kingdom of God. Now, we've said it here over and over again, but this is important. Because you go out into the workplace, which is worship, you go out into your neighborhoods. You're with family. And they ask you questions. What do you think about gay marriage? What do you think about abortion? What do you think about this? And you need to stand up and say, it doesn't matter what I think. God, all I can tell you is what my government says. The argument is not with me, it's with my government. Well, you so-and-so, don't blame me, it's my government. Take it up with my king. Let's see where you stand before him in the end. Well, look at those Christians. Don't look at them. Believe me, judgment begins in the house of God. Don't look at them. But that's discipline, because God loves us, and those who don't get disciplined aren't sons. Oh, this is better than getting amens. It's true, church. And so we have to stand up in our roles at work, even what we've been given at birth. Grace is another issue that is determined at birth. We did not choose it. We need to love it. What nation? Here in Kenya, it's tribe against tribe. And yet, James chapter 3, when talking about the wisdom of God, eight attributes of God's wisdom mentioned in James 3:17. And in verse 18, he says, and the fruit of righteousness that is sown in peace by those who make peace. See, the fruit of righteousness is not peacekeeping, it's peacemaking. It's taking two things at odds with one another and reconciling them, bringing them together. That's the redemption of our God. That's the ministry of reconciliation. That's the ministry of that ambassador. When you're in the workplace, you've got two people at odds with one another. To be able to step in and bring reconciliation shows that you are a son and daughter of righteousness. When you see Christians putting down, slandering, fighting, speaking negative and everything else, realize they're moving by earthly wisdom. When you see that in the home, dads and moms, husbands and wives, when you see that in the home, we need to recognize that's devilish wisdom at work. But we don't. We get caught up in it. How many can say that's true? How many ever had an argument with your spouse on the way to assembling together? Work. You see, even in the issue of race, and why I'm so strong on this, because whatever race God ordained for us, he said, you're going to be my example to show how we all get along, every tongue, tribe, people, and nation. And so if you are of a race and you're with people that same race who are putting down other races, we do not stand in that place. We say, that's not acceptable to me. We have to do something different. We have to show something different, church. Can I get a good amen on that one? We really have to show something that is absolutely different than what we see. So, work. Now, I want to go on to this because this is where I want to talk. I don't think I'll get done today, but we'll continue on. How many of you know that warfare is worship? So you got this onslaught of philosophies, ideologies, accusations, everything else coming at you. And the first thing we think is, that dirty person. We lose it when somebody pulls out in front of us. Have you ever said, you idiot? How many? Fess up. Good for the soul. I've said it. Knowing I shouldn't, I've still said it, and I've had to repent. Right, Lord, that wasn't right. How many of you hear me? Lord, that's not right. How many people have called you an idiot when you pulled out in front of somebody because you weren't paying attention or whatever? You know, we've got to, you know, our words should build up, not tear down. And so we have all these tests and all this warfare, but warfare, just like work, imagine if you get up every morning and say, I'm going to worship today. I don't care if I have to pull that lever 1,000 times today. I don't care how mundane it seems to others. I'm going to be praising God. I'm going to be the best lever puller there ever was. My boss is going to walk down the aisle and say, you're a good lever puller. No job. I watch people every day. I go through the down and get my coffee. Good rapport with all of them there. I take it as a test. one gal there, you could just tell she had a rough life, She was a new worker, started going through there, and all the rest of them know me, and we get along fine and everything. And she's there, and I, you know, good morning, how you doing today, and all this, and she was just gruff. Why? She's been beat up in life. And so I started talking to her like I did all the rest of them. Within a week, all of a sudden she was smiling every time I came to the window for my coffee and saying good morning. You have the authority to shift the atmosphere, not only in your life, but other people's life. If you're willing to war, not only for yourself, but if you're willing to be a warrior for others, you're going to have to fight for your kids every day. Every day you're going to have to fight for them. And so this week, as we go on, we're going to learn five attitudes that Nehemiah lays out in chapter 4 of how to be victorious. What precedes a victory? What precedes every victory? A battle. There is no victory without a battle. What precedes every testimony? A test. Think it not strange when these fiery trials come upon you. And we're going to see why this is so important and how we win. But warfare is worship. Worship. Psalms 149. When you read Psalm 149 and all the instruments and the dancing before the Lord, to do what? To do what? What does worship do? What does he say it does? It executes what? Vengeance on our enemies. Do you want to know one of the most powerful weapons you can ever use or wield against your enemies? Love. What did he tell us to? Bless them. Love is like heaping hot coals on their head. Now, we don't do it because we want to see them burn, but it's something they cannot handle in the natural because it is a powerful spiritual weapon because our weapons are not natural. They're spiritual to pulling down strongholds. And so we're going to be voiced. How many of you ever cast a demon out of somebody? Do we think demons no longer exist? A good portion of Jesus' ministry was dealing and confronting warfare, demonic spirits, demonic philosophies, and everything else. Church, we've got to learn to deal with these things. How many believe that the darkness is going to get worse? The Bible says it is. We ought to believe it. Guess what? We are the light. And the darker it gets, the brighter we shine. We are here for a reason. So, work is worship. We execute vengeance on his enemies with our praise, with our worship. What does God inhabit? Our praises. We're down and out. We're depressed. What do we put on? The garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. These aren't just cute little refrigerator door verses. They're actual truths that give us the victory. Amen? So as we look at this, and as we look at this warfare, and we see that work is worship, go with me to Judges. Hold your place in chapter 4 there. Go with me to Judges. Chapter 3. Judges chapter 3. I'm just going to take my time on this because I feel learning to do warfare is extremely important for us. provision because you realize God's your provider. See, once you realize He's your provider, then you don't have to worry about your provision. You're just faithful to do what you're given to do. Okay? And you see stuff going on there. See, we are so caught up, I'm going to be honest with it, with ourselves. All of us, myself, all of us. Doesn't that happen? What are my needs? We're so caught up in that that what happens is we're insensitive to the hurting all around us. Isn't that true? That worker there that's going through all kinds of things. And yet, at that point, they are very tender for the Lord. They may have resisted you all the time, but now they're going through a divorce. All of a sudden, now they're tender before the Lord, and they're open to hear what you've shared with them before, but now their heart is receptive. They just lost a loved one or something's happened. Their heart that was closed is now open and receptive. God wants to create in us such a spiritual sensitivity that, boy, the devil and all his host tread, fear us in whatever environment we are so in. Why? Because we are marching under the orders of the captain of the host, the Lord himself. Judges chapter 3, we find here, beginning in verse 1, I'll just keep it short here. Now, these are the nations which the Lord left. Say left. That he might test, say test. Israel by them, that is all who had not known any of the wars in Canaan. This was only so that the generations of the children of Israel might be taught to know war, at least those who had not formerly known it. God did this. God did this. Parents, if we don't teach our children to war, the generations to war. How to battle. How to stand up against the philosophies. How to stand. Look at the division in this nation. We can be part of the division. We can be part of the problem, or we can be an answer. It doesn't matter how you vote. It's a matter how you live your life. It's how you talk. It's what you represent. It's what you get out there. I'm not always popular for saying that. It's like I say, I'm not a Republican. I'm not a Democrat. I'm not even an independent. I'm utterly dependent. And that's how I choose to vote. Some people choose not to vote. That's between, you all have to live your heart before God. So what I'm saying in all this, we can be part, the sons of righteousness are those who are peacemakers. And that's why even out in D.C. that's so politically charged, we say this is an apolitical meeting. And Todd, is it having effect? Mike and Penny, is it having an effect? Yes, it is. There are those out there that live and in governance and in the political environment who are carrying the message of the kingdom, no matter what side of the aisle they're sitting. So he leaves them in the land. Go with me to Psalms 144. Somebody read, start reading verse 1, first couple verses there. Psalm 144. Amen. Now, God gave us in the garden that we were subdued. But he says he subdues people. But what does David pray? Blessed be the Lord who does what? Trains my hands for war. How many of you want your hands, spiritual hands, to be trained for war? This is a charge today. And we'll get into the practice next week, but this is a charge today. That we have to set our minds, set our will, that our hands will be trained for war, spiritual warfare. And that with our children, our grandchildren, or whatever, we're going to help them understand and see that their hands are trained for war. Now, let me say this. Scripture comes to me. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1 and following, Paul talks to Timothy about committing these things unto faithful men who are able to teach others also. But he goes on to talk about a good soldier does not get entangled with the affairs of this world. Let me ask you a question for all of us. How many of us are unduly entangled with the affairs of this world? Because if we are, and so we look at the Word of God, we take all these scriptures and admonitions. If you go through the scripture, the amount of language that's used about warfare, overcomer, more than a conqueror, the fight of faith, putting on the whole armor of God, taking up the sword of the Spirit, the shield of faith to quench the fiery darts of the enemy. All these scriptures, God is telling us something. That He is the Lord of a massive army. So let's go back to Nehemiah, chapter 4. Nehemiah, chapter 4. Now, I want to say this. When you're living life in the Lord, you don't have to look for battles. It's like, you know, demon hunters out there. You don't have to look for battles. How many of you know they find you? Why? Because all who wish to live God in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. They'll find you. And matter of fact, they'll come from without and they'll come from within. If you look at chapter 4, let's go there. Let's look at verse 1, starting verse 1. But it so happened when Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall that he was furious and very indignant. And he mocked the Jews. How many of you have been mocked? Don't worry about it. In other words, the battle will come from without. Those without, you go sit down in the lunchroom or something and you'll hear all the stuff going on and you'll be mocked because you don't participate with it. Just love. Return love. It will happen. The battle will come from without. As a matter of fact, we see that there was, in verse 1 through 3, a form of intimidation. They'll try to intimidate you. If you share something, for example, if you share something that lines up with God's Word and so against what the world believes out there, you'll feel intimidation coming at you all the time. Stand your ground. But like I say, do it this way. Don't say, well, I think or I feel. Doesn't matter what you think or feel. Seriously, hear me. When you say, my government, here's what my government says. What do you mean your government? You're an American. Yes, I'm an American citizen, but I live by a government higher than mine. And all of a sudden you share with them, this is what the words say. So you're telling me to be disobedient to God. Well, that's what, yes, you're telling me to be disobedient to God. So we stand our ground. When we go down to the mockery here, go down to verse 7 of chapter 4. Now it happened when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, and the Ammonites, heard that the walls of Jerusalem were being restored and that gaps were beginning to be closed, that they became very angry. And all of them conspired together to come and attack Jerusalem and create confusion. So here's the enemy from without. Let's go further down the chapter because I want to bring another point out here. And it's on this last point that we'll stop today. And then next week we'll get into the practice and attitudes of warfare. When you come down here to verse 10 of chapter 4, then Judah said, the strength of the laborers is failing, and there is so much rubbish that we're not able to build. 12. So it was when the Jews who dwelt near them came that they told us 10 times, whatever place you turn, they will be upon us. In other words, they came and discouraged them, intimidated them from finishing the work. Now, I want you to understand how the enemy works, because we are not ignorant of the wiles of the devil. He'll use discouragement and everything else. He'll intimidate you. He'll do it. How many have ever been, you sense the Lord leading you to do something, to step out and do something in the workplace or wherever you're at, step out and do something, and all of a sudden you say, I can't do it. All the fear comes upon you, intimidation, everything else. If I do that, they're going to think this. Many times, an unhealthy desire for respect quenches the anointing. If this is warfare, then we need to gird our minds to do battle. We need to see that our hands are trained for war. Let me talk about another enemy with you. Lies. The devil can't be everywhere. He's not omnipresent. Christians talk about him like he is. He is not. A third of the angels fell. How many does that leave for us? Thank you. How many know we got angels assigned to us? Do you believe that? There are literally angels assigned to you and I. The devil cannot be everywhere. And therefore, the victory has already been determined for us. And we need to stand up. So this enemy within, intimidation, fear, everything comes against us. I battle it. You battle it. But here's something else that comes up from within. What brought them down in the garden? In Genesis chapter 3. It was a lie. Basically, he said the same word that God said and tweaked just a little point of it. You see how philosophies are working with our children, our grandchildren, and everything else in this nation? Where are the parents who will stand up? Where are the parents who will be courageous? In the midst of the system of education, in the midst of academia, where are those who will stand up and say, I do not ride with that trip? That's not the journey I'm on. God craned my hands to war. But here's what gets us from within. The pride of life. Everyone who has killed it completely, stand up, please. Lust of the eye. How many know those war within? And so we could say, woe is me. No, we are more than conquerors in Christ Jesus. But what I want us to walk out of here with today, echoing in our hearts and in our minds, for the sake of our families, for the sake of our neighbors, for the sake of our fellow workers, for the sake of our children, for the sake of our grandchildren. How many grandparents see things their grandchildren are doing that concern you? Raise your hand if that's you. We don't stop. We don't give up. We'll embrace those five attitude characteristics that Nehemiah brings out. But I want us to walk away with this determination, where throughout this week and throughout our lives, we say, Lord, train my hands to war. I'm in the midst of all these enemies and I'm the only one, I will declare your cause. If all the Philistines are over there and a giant is standing before me, I will declare your cause. Because I'm a leader in your hearts. That's who I am. Amen. What we're going to do now, I'm going to have Todd come forward and just lead us. We're going to pray for a couple who's retired but refired. And I'll let Todd give a statement here, and then we're going to pray for that couple because we won't see them in our midst as much. And we want to bless them and commission them and send them.
Amen. Just to preface, just before I do that, I want to just briefly follow up with something Ron touched, speaking of Nehemiah in the fourth chapter. And I want to read the full of verse 9 in chapter 4, and it says this: But we prayed to our God, which many of us do, and we guarded the city day and night. Prayer is great, but there's an action that took place with that. We prayed, but we also guarded the city day and night. I'm going to have Mike and Penny Norman, if you would, come forward. This is a family that we've known for nigh on 40 years, and they had been a part of this fellowship many, many years ago. Then for a season, they were elsewhere, and they just really felt the need to come back. God brought them back to this place, and I know them very well. They're very close to us, and they've shared just what, you know, this fellowship has meant to them. But I want to go back to the very beginning of this service when Ron was talking about Pete Norman, which is one of their boys. There are two other boys in their family. When the boys were young, they stayed the course and they earnestly prayed for their family, and they also acted in guarding that family. Now, that's not to say that their boys didn't stray and do the things that young men and young women do. But they stayed the course, trained them up in the way that they should go. And when they were old, or when they are old, they will not depart. Two of the boys are actively serving Christ today. The other one, he's right there. And we're still believing for him. But I want to say it's because they caught the cause. And they realized that they needed to impart and always to remain encouraging to their boys in good times and not so good times. And the result is one of them has the testimony of actually having an impact in Washington, D.C. I think that's powerful. What we want to do, Mike and Penny just recently retired, and they've traveled some, and they'll travel some more. But they have said this: they may actually light somewhere else, but this place will always be their base. But the thing that they talked to Ron and I about the other day was, is our heart is to be commissioned in the service of the Lord, to be the very oracle, as it were, to represent him no matter where they go. And there were many words that actually were spoken to them when we were in D.C. concerning that. Caleb, would you come forward, please? Ron? What we want to do is literally commission into the passion of their heart. See, they're not retiring. They just retired from one position to serve full-time in another position. And so if you would you extend your hands to this couple? Father, we are so grateful that we have them as active members of not only this congregation, but of the body of Christ. And their heart, Lord, is to go and to continue to serve, Lord Jesus, to literally be your representation no matter where they go. I hear that time and again from both of them, Lord. One is prophetic, the other has the gift of wisdom, but both encourage all the time. They can't help themselves. That's who they are. And so, Father, now as the elders of this church, Lord God, as we lay hands on them, Lord Jesus, we are declaring and commissioning them into the service that you have called them, Lord God. For now, Lord, their scope is about to expand, Lord Jesus, and how they may serve in other places. And so, Father, right now we speak a great grace upon them, Lord, to literally be your word sent forth, Lord God. And we pray as it is sent forth, it will do the work that it is called to do and not fall to the ground without having discovered or do what you said it would do. So, Father, we together agree together in commissioning them into your service, Lord God. And we pray even for a greater grace in these days, Lord. We ask, Lord God, that you would use them in greater ways, Lord, that you would free them from the confines of what once held them, Lord God, so that they might serve you in a greater capacity. We look forward to the days ahead and the testimonies that they'll bring back to us, Lord God. We now, as a congregation, speak a blessing over them. We ask that you watch them in their going, Lord, and their returning, Lord Jesus. Bless them in their going out and